What up? What up?
What's up, dude?
Ooh, sorry.
What's going on?
Kid wouldn't get to bed, brother. How are you?
Good, man. How are you?
I'm good. I don't like to be late ever, but this guy just wouldn't want to go down. It's Ethan, just sleeping.
Baby monitor, portable.
Baby monitor, yeah. Melissa's got a thing to go to tonight, so I'm watching little E-Man, but just put him to bed to get to the Dutch. How you doing, bro? Love the shirt. Man.
Yeah. Yeah, I like this
one. Heard that place is magical. You told me the place is magical.
Yeah. Yep. But yeah, pretty good. It was kind of an off day for me. I played the session, the Irish session last night. And
yeah,
that always tends to run later than you think. And it's in Fitchburg, so I got a kind of a ride. So I just hung out with the dog all day, did some shit in the yard, and fucking worked on some musical things, and it was a good relaxing day.
I don't have a single.
Does your hat match your username? Wit?
Built Wit. Yeah, this is another thing. I don't have my computer. This is my old computer. Built Wit. It's a tech company that works with different builders, so I guess it does, but... Mm-hmm. I hide myself when we do these because I don't like to look at myself. So I go to the gallery, whatever, and I say, hide myself. Don't show myself.
Yeah. Yeah. That's a good call. Yeah, I should try that too.
It just helps with the paying attention. I don't know. I'm good now. Cheers, man.
Cheers, buddy. So yeah, excited for our guest today.
Long time coming.
Yeah, another Gleason Road alumni.
I know, right?
And yeah, a street runner till this day.
Yeah.
Mr. Yeah. Tough Guy, Kyle Howe.
Is he in the waiting room?
He's been waiting, yep. We're gonna reveal this fine gentleman.
Hey, Howe.
Hello. Gentlemen.
Hello.
Hello, brother.
You boys, huh?
What's up? What's up?
Shout, John. It's still good to see you, fellas.
Good to see you, man.
Look at that 16 ouncer, baby.
There you go. There you go.
Like the rules called for.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Because
you're on a computer. You're on a computer.
Cheers, Kyle. What's going on today?
Cheers, John. Not much. I just, having a day, just wondering about my podcast career and how it's going to go. So, you know, I was just. You know, I'm sure you guys went to work like a normal day, and I was just so stressed out. So,
Pete.
You know, I hear that from people. I hear people are like, "Oh, I'm nervous. I'm nervous before I go on," and then they come on. They're
clearly,
like,
you're not. Like, you feel mad comfortable with those glasses, huh? You feel obviously comfortable. That's what I'm saying. Jesus Christ.
these are some goggles.
Yeah. Okay.
Those keep getting thicker and thicker over the years, Pete.
Yeah,
I have saw those.
They're pretty thick. I'm out of contact, so.
Like I said to you guys in the message, it's like I've watched most of these, and it's been a hell of a ride. Like it's a great trip down memory lane. Mm-hmm. Like these are stories that like fuck I forgot about, which isn't too much of a fucking like far reach, but like I don't know. You listen to fucking Dan last weekend. It was awesome. Like,
so was that true? Did Dan hypnotize you?
You
don't remember. Maybe
I'm still hypnotized. I don't know, dude. Like I remember the story differently, and maybe my mom just never called, but
yeah.
I remember, I don't want to say this a lot, but Mero was with us. Mero was one of the other ones, dude. Mero was in that base.
Nice.
Right? Nice.
Yeah. I know. I love
to say that, dude. Yeah, he lives.
He's
right
still over there or what? Where's he at? Don't know.
I know he was out in Cali for a minute. He was out in California for a minute.
Me and my special guest. Hold on.
Oh, look at this fucking roll up.
He's always there.
Just lurking.
I thought it was going to be Eileen.
I'm surprised
Eileen
you're not blurred out right now, Bri.
He told me that, dude. There's one time, though, me and, there goes my AirPod, but One time, me and Bri went to the Shell on Route 9 across from where my parents live, across from Fairlawn.
Mero was there,
and we get out of the car, we're going in, and he's coming out, and he's like, "Oh, Kyle, I remember when you were just such a little dude," and we were just like, "We're the fucking same age, dude. Like, we grew up together." I know. he punked me. He's like, "I remember when you were a little dude." I was like, "What, dude?" Like,
well, I happen to remember when we were both little dudes, dude.
Yeah, I was like, all right, I don't know what to say.
He's a good shit. I always liked Mero. He was a good shit.
Oh, he's always a good, he always meant so, like, he always meant well. He just got such a bad rap coming over. Like, but he punked me that time. I didn't know what to say. I was just like, fuck, man. Maybe I was little. I don't know. But yeah, it's been awesome to see. I've watched most of these, and it's been great to like just kind of like catch up with people and see people that have, you know, like Colin or like Dan, that have been just so successful with something that they're so passionate about, and like it's so fucking cool to see, and like to go down these walks and like obviously, like, you know, I'm boys with you guys, I haven't seen you in a bit, but like it's fun to see people that you don't talk to, you know, on the daily. So this has been awesome, and I hope you keep doing it, and happy to chop it up with the fellas.
Hell yeah, brother. It's the
glasses. What are you drinking today? We got a 16 ouncer.
I know. So I don't even have one. Here I am.
No.
Yeah. So you can already dog on me, Kyle.
He's got a 12 ouncer.
What? Can you hear me now? Am I still on mute?
We can hear you.
Okay. No, I mean, Kyle. I knew Kyle could always dog on me because he's always got some shit about me. I pinged saying, make sure you bring a 16-ouncer, and sure enough, I don't bring one. And I also am like a stickler about being on time. And of course, I was late. Kyle's sitting in the waiting room, like, where the hell is this guy?
You also said I had to stop at a gas station to get a 16-ouncer. You know they sell these at fucking liquor stores. Why do I gotta go to a gas station?
Like, yeah, especially in Tennessee, like, man. Those fucking tall boys are everywhere.
We got a black and mild, a tall boy, keep it moving.
So, yeah, I mean, it's been a throwback sort of podcast, but it's also been a throwback freaking Gleason Road podcast.
I know. I do. I've been getting those. I think, was Jimmy Golden going to be next, dude?
I don't know. If you got his contact information, maybe.
I could probably get in touch with Darlene, dude. She's my girl. Maybe I'll reach out to Evan. He can touch base with her. I don't know, dude.
Darlene, she was such a sweetheart. Still is.
She was the best. She was the best.
Yeah. Are your folks still over there?
They are. Yeah, they are. They are still living in the compound. It's called a home. We just call it a home. It's not Waco. We just call it a home. I got no fucking Davidians over there, but we call it family. But yeah, whatever you want to do. No, they built the garage. Yeah, they built the garage behind the house. So.
With rooms over the garage. Do you still have the above ground?
The pool is still there. They did put rooms above the garage. I get what you're saying. The garage is bigger than the house, but
yeah,
that's what happens when you live in a Fairlawn neighborhood, years. Dude. I remember your parents building the Arita house, and just we used to go over there, and it was just a frame. And they would go over to like make decisions, and we just think it was the coolest thing ever. We'd just be like fucking running around like fucking James Bond, just in a framed out house, thinking it was the greatest thing ever.
Yeah.
And then we'd have to go back to fucking like Oak Street or fucking Tatum, and just be like, all right, go to bed. I'm like, this sucks. I remember playing. It's fucking Irita. Kev, I feel like Kev used to be downstairs, and we used to go downstairs and play like Wolfenstein 64 on the computer.
Sick, dude. Throwback.
We'd be up to like 4 a.m., dude.
Yes, yes.
And then like Wolfenstein was like over the stairs, so we like would clear out the bathroom and run through it, jump through the hallway, and like if you could sick flip onto the bed, you were going to be a great wrestler. None of us turned out to be great wrestlers or wrestlers at all. So I don't know. I don't know if it was a tried and true method, but here we are.
Yeah. I always think it's crazy when you show me pictures of Georgie, because Georgie is locked in my brain as he was when I was over there, right? When you're like, oh yeah, Georgie's getting married. I'm like,
he's like a Georgie character from Jumanji.
Like, but yeah, exactly.
Like, who was Georgie? George who?
He's my little brother.
Oh, your little brother. Yeah.
So back like when we were growing up, my little brother, he was, shit, if we were in first grade, you know, he was just being born. But as we got a little bit older, he did too. And like, he was just, you know, as bad as a kid I thought I was. And he turned out to be a great kid, but he'd always be like, I'm grounded, doubt it, and jump out like a second floor window. And we'd be like at my parents' house and just see like a boxer kid jump out the second floor window and just sprint off and be like, who's that? And be like, that's my
he was brother. Reckless. We were bad, but we still had like a little bit of a sense of, you know, Jimmy.
My parents got whooped my ass. Like, yeah, I had a sense of that. Yeah.
It's like, he was like, and I'm like, oh shit. Yeah.
He's so, like a wild thornberry. He was the little guy there.
Yes, that's Georgie. That's Georgie.
Yeah. There's a lot of, like, growing up in that neighborhood, it was so fucking funny. It was just so much shit. It was just an easy way to grow up with so many people, and then, you know, everyone kind of, you know, moved on. And then it was just like, it was like, as a kid though, it was fucking such a perfect place to grow up.
Yeah, it was. The bikes, the bike races, the jumps, the everything. If your folks are still over there, and you're over there from time to time, who's still there? Are the Moynas still there? I know Fuzzy
Mary,
guy.
There he is. Dude, what a wild fucking story that is.
I don't know it exactly. I just know he passed away, but we don't have to talk about it.
This isn't live.
Right? Okay. We don't edit either. So, okay. I mean, did he have a heart attack or?
Well, you know how he always, like, he always drove his limos or his little limos. He always worked on those shits in the yard.
Mm-hmm.
Right? No. That. No,
not limos. I remember that little truck.
So they had the long yard, and right next to Ann's house, he had the fence, and he used to park his cars there and work on them.
Mm-hmm.
One day, the car fell on him.
Oh, that's no. How he died. Oh, I didn't know that.
Fucking nightmare, dude.
Oh.
E-brake, dude.
Oh, man. Yeah. Really?
But it's on the grass, and it's just like, yeah. But I hate to say that story, but he's someone like at Jimmy Golden's house, like me and Dan Moyna, we used to just get into, like, those are some of the first fights I ever enjoyed.
Yeah.
For like, sure. We'd just be on first base, just like, you didn't throw me out. Fuck you.
I know.
Just so uncalled for.
Like, I know.
It was just so unnecessary, it was just happening.
It's a little bit like, you know, like Lord of the Flies, in that, like, you kind of stated your claim as to who you were in this tribe. And Kyle was a big man. I was a fast man.
He was a fast man.
But we
also figured out, like, if you piece together friendships, you know, you get a long way.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So Cullen was also a big man. Cullen's parents took him out of the situation. They were like, this isn't working for you mentally. Yeah. They were like, this isn't going well at all.
We knew it wasn't exactly right.
You and Cullen.
That's kids. He's the reason. He's probably the reason I started playing football, because he lived on Gleason, and his parents put him in football like early on. Like, see, if I started early Pop Warner, he started the year before me,
mm-hmm.
and he was just like, it was so sick. So I started, and that's actually a funny story, because like, obviously you both know Al Lucas.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's how, like, me and Al met, is through Pop Warner football. But Al could never tell the difference between me and Cullen, because back at that time, Cullen and Pete, you can attest to Cullen and I looked exactly the same. We were just big headed.
I got the best
dumb fucking idiots. Like,
I got the best first communion photo of us three. It's just like, you know the one I'm talking about?
Yeah. Oh,
it's just the three of us. And
my,
it's like,
my
you
first
and Cullen.
Communion photo has floated around quite a bit. So.
Yes. You have a very famous first communion photo.
Which is, you know, it's tough. Of all pictures of me, I don't think that's the one I'd like floating around, but fuck, here we are. So what are you going to do? Right?
It's not a bad one.
But have you seen my pictures lately? No, but
you look great, man.
Thanks, man. You do.
You golfing a lot?
I'm
trying to.
Oh, I don't think they can hear you. I think I got the mic, right? No, I've golfed twice this year. We went once at Green Hill, and it was the fucking only day in April. It was 100 degrees, which was turned out to be the worst decision. But shot at 98. Went the next day at Kettle Brook, shot at 92. So
nice.
As far as I know.
Head in the right direction.
You're
one of those golfers I've golfed with where like this guy can break 90 and there's the rest of us can't. Have you always been good at golf or have you broke 90? You haven't.
I broke 90, but I've never, like, I started golf late. Mm-hmm. I was 18, 19. A lot of it had to do with Bri and his dad, Rick, really. I used to go on vacations with the Terrells. And we used to go to Myrtle Beach, and most of that was just, you know, me and Brad would wake up late. We'd hit a lazy fucking river. We'd get drunk. Classic, you know.
Yeah.
Classic, you know, us. But then Rick was like, yo, come golfing. So here it is, my first time golfing. I'm on a Myrtle Beach course, and I don't know if you know much about golfing.
I was
Myrtle
there Beach, not too long ago. It's good.
Myrtle Beach is like the fucking place you go when you want to golf.
Yeah, yeah.
And I couldn't have dug this lawn up quicker. I had the landscaping crew behind me, just like, who the fuck is this guy? Like, it was tough. And Rick, the whole time, you're the greatest golfer ever. No one's ever hit a ball like that. Man. I was like, Rick, this, like, I'm not stupid.
He has a permanent smile on his face.
Dude, if you could drive your ball into the ground and he would, like, you look back at him, he is just, he's like, that's the greatest shot I've ever seen. It's unbelievable. So but yeah, so if you're ever feeling down on yourself, you're feeling bad about your golf game, do yourself a favor. Go with Rick.
Rick. He'll turn it around.
Mentally, physically, it's on you. But
I've only been golfing once this summer, and it was over at Myrtle Beach. I had to go to Myrtle Beach to see a client, and took me golfing. It was the first time.
Huh?
It was really nice. And there was two freaking alligators on the course that I was like, oh, look at that. And they were like, dude, that's real. I was, because they're so still. I thought it was like a prop. And they're like, dude, don't go close to that. That's real. And I'm like, I don't know what you're talking about. I've never seen one before. Well, like that. And it had one eye.
Should I take a selfie with one eye? Wrestling it. Like,
look at Chubbs Peterson.
Yeah, Chubbs. It had to be Scott.
How big was it, Pete? How big were they?
I mean, 15 feet long, like freaking thick. Yeah, we're talking big things. Yeah, Kyle, did you see one out there when you were in Myrtle?
No, I didn't. We did see a Portuguese man of war in the water though, which was pretty, like, it's pretty alarming when you see one of those in real life. It's just like a jellyfish, but not. It's like a invisible stringy jellyfish. It was. I don't know, because I went with Bri, and Bri had already gone down there. He had told me a story about, like, him seeing someone swimming in the ocean and, like, getting attacked by jellyfish and rescuing them. So I'm already on, like, edge, and we're in there, and it's just fucking thing that it's probably 8 feet of strings. You just kind of figure out. It's huge, dude.
The man of war?
I've heard of it.
Man of war. Portuguese man of war.
This thing looks wild.
It's terrifying, dude. And you don't see it until you're in it. Well, it's called Portuguese man of war. And if you can show me how many wars Portuguese people have won, then I'd like to argue them.
Show me your best soccer player. So Kyle, Bonner wants to switch it up and throw some curveballs here and there. I might throw it out early.
Sure. So I've watched a few of these. I know how it goes.
Well, I mean, we're throwing a new curveball out, which is will be weird. But have you had any ghost stories to tell? Have you had any encounters with any extraterrestrial life or ghost stories? I'll throw freaking aliens in there too, just to mix it up to see
what ghost your life stories.
Paranormal stories.
Paranormal, we'll call it. If you don't, then you don't. But I was just curious because
I don't think so. I'm not really someone that believes in ghosts, really. I mean, I believe in afterlife, but I don't believe in ghosts, I would say. I guess
that is exactly the answer I'd expect from Kyle Howe. He's like, well, there was this one time it could have been a ghost, but I knocked him out.
No, I didn't say that. Like, I believe in afterlife, but I feel like at this point, if I was going to see some ghosts, I would have saw some ghosts. Like,
yeah,
I've gone down that hole enough times.
How about you, Bonner?
No,
you,
I'm trying to think too, and I don't really have anything that sticks out terribly bad, but you know, dreams that later seem to like
deja vu stuff
play out, like premonition type dreams.
Well, there's a lot of things like, and I don't want to speak for you guys, but a lot of people, if you like say if you smoke weed, you don't get the dream as well. And I'm gonna say that is false, because I do, yeah, because I just woke up from a crazy.
I have a hard time that, dude. Dreaming, like, when I'm smoking weed, dude. I very rarely.
I guess
dream.
I don't know. I usually smoke to go to sleep, so it's. And I don't wake up like right away thinking of a dream, but there's many a days that like I'll wake up in the morning just from a dream, and I can remember that, and then.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I don't know. It's not a ghost story, but it's definitely like. Something that you wake up thinking about, and which just kind of throws you off for the first little bit, you know. You start your day instead of like, you know, fucking feeling hyped up. You're kind of questioning what just went through your fucking mind.
For sure.
It's like what? Yeah, it's like, well, whether it was good or bad. Like,
do you have a football dream? You forgot your helmet. The classic. Forgot your uniform. Forgot your cleats.
That's
recurring.
I do remember like back. Back in the day when I was, when I first started as a freshman, when we'd play varsity, I'd get home from those varsity games, I would go to bed and you'd wake up. It's just like you just wake up with like a jolt. And it was just like you, in your mind, you like saw a play and you were either getting tackled or making the tackle. And that's how you'd wake up. And like,
yeah, just adrenaline.
Yeah, it was fucking weird. Like,
I only have dreams when I'm like either napping or I've woken up, let's say around 4 o'clock, and then fall back asleep.
You just wake up around 4 o'clock.
I don't know. For some reason, I wake up early and then I go back to sleep and then I wake up again. I think it's just because I remember it. Maybe, I don't know, the different levels of your REM state or whatever.
Yeah.
But if I'm in a lighter sleep, you know what I think is fucking true is Inception, because the dreams I have are freaking long.
Crazy,
the dreams I have are freaking long, and when I wake up, my wife wakes me up or something like that.
It's
I'm
like
only
20 minutes,
for an hour.
Dude. It's like 20 minutes, man. It's
not
crazy,
even an hour.
Dude.
20 minutes, and I it's a whole lifetime. So that is a bizarre thing, because I mean, obviously Christopher, what's his name, Nolan knows his stuff, it's probably built on some true shit. So,
well, lucid dreaming. I mean, when you have these dreams, Pete, can you actually interface with the world around you?
It's happened to me. It's happened to me a couple times.
It's actually, if you have a wet dream, that's pretty much
yeah. You know what? You know, yeah. So it's happened to me a couple of times, Bonner, and if I'm ever aware that I am dreaming and it's a scenario where like I want to hook up with, it never comes to fruition.
Yeah, you wake up.
Yeah. You're like, oh.
Yeah, I gotta get out of this one. This is gonna work.
I think there's some. There's an art to that. I think people practice that.
Like, maybe Dan Munier teaches it.
Yeah, I've read into it a little bit. Like, it's a really interesting subject. Some people call it like astral projection, or lucid dreaming. And one trick that I was reading on was to take a nap, like during the middle of the day, and set an alarm for a specific time that's like. Not REM, but like right before or something is like
it's kind of like
the ideal spot that you want to dream at. And I've tried it. I just can't get the hang of it, because as soon as I try to interface, I wake up. Like I just immediately know it's a dream and I'm back. You know,
there's sometimes I have like kind of got like you kind of wake up just like,
yeah,
whoa, like what the fuck, like what's going on here? Like
that's kind of like your, are you really fully awake?
That
Yeah, that's I know the area that right there that I'm talking about is like.
And then Rico's got to like shit outside. So I'm like, yeah, I'm definitely awake, dude. These fucking dogs got to go to the bath.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, I've had some dreams that have been so. I've had some freaking deja vu. I think that's the weirdest thing. Deja vu is one.
I know, but since the Matrix, dude, I think the deja vu.
I think the Matrix is the best definition for it. Because why? How else?
I think so, the brain records everything. We just don't have the mental capacity to remember everything.
Yeah, I think you're right.
So when we have deja vu, maybe it's just like a dream that we often forget our dreams.
Are there beings remembering this? Like there's no way you went through that exact like experience at that same time.
Oh, like past life kind of shit.
Yeah.
Like, oh, that's a different take on it. I wasn't gonna say that take. I'd say my take on it, dude. My takes are either the Matrix, like this is a simulation and there's like an edit, like they're legitimately the Matrix reason, like there's a mess up in the code, or there's like this weird thing in time and space and that's not really real and you have lived this before and you've done this before and
opposite takes. So what are you thinking?
Well, I don't know. I when I think about deja vu, I think it would be one of the two. I never thought of it what you said, Kyle, which was it even you?
That's not like you don't like.
Those creepy 2-year olds who say something to their mother like, "I was a soldier in a last life, and I've killed many men," and just freaking their fucking parents out, dude.
Those people are fucking crazy, dude. Like sick on them if they're just like going for the vine or like the views. But
there's
like
more than one account of that too, man.
There's a lot.
And there's one of them. I don't like. I think what you're going on, Bonnet. Like there's one of them that are like speaks, and it almost goes into like the Dalai Lama stuff, which is how they choose the Dalai Lama. They like, choose a bunch of like fucking children. Mm-hmm. They like point at something that belongs to the Dalai Lama, and if you point at the right thing, it, like. Come, what are we fucking doing here? Like, mm-hmm. Like, hey, if you see the red thing, you point to the fucking red thing. All right, you're the Dalai Lama now. Like, how
is
like,
that how it works? Doing? I don't even know.
Yeah, that's how choosing the new Dalai Lama, they will take the newborns and line them up. And that's how they choose the new Dalai Lama. Is if you they take something that belonged to the old Dalai Lama, line it up, and if they point to something, because they believe in reincarnation. So they believe that that baby or the Dalai Lama lives in that baby. So if he points to something that was that Dalai Lama's, that is the new Dalai Lama, which is insane.
That is insane.
Like, right? That's fucking insane.
Like, I didn't even know that.
I apologize if really anyone believes in that shit, but that's Dalai fucking Lama. Insane.
That, well, what's insane about it? The belief in it, or you think, or the.
No, the idea that they have kids choose who the next Dalai Lama is going to be, and then they live their lives based on this person's ideals for the next fucking 70, 80 years. That's insane.
Yeah.
That's insane. Okay.
That's not very practical.
And at what point, if you're choosing the new one of the 2, 3, 4-year-old, and you're living off this guy's ideals for the last fucking 200 years, at what point does it become antiquated and like makes no sense? Like, but here we are. That's why this, you know, this country's this way. We got a bunch of fucking.
Yeah, it's like, you know, I. What about the broad like definition of reincarnation itself? I mean, I personally think every soul is born in a unique, original soul, but
it comes from somewhere,
we are
right?
Recycled, you know, and just getting assigned a whole new consciousness, you know, and memory and everything.
Agree. I don't know how else to look at it. Like, I completely agree with you. Like, I don't know.
If that's the case, then where's the point of the recycling?
Recycling?
like recycling into new bodies.
Yeah. So like where's the point of that transfer? Because I do believe that we have an energy, right? And and so like if we're destroyed or whatever, the energy is not.
Well, you can't destroy energy.
Right. So if you're going down that path, then where does it enter a new being?
Yeah. I mean, you could argue that everyone's original and fresh.
Well, I was going to tell you here.
That's what
I'd
you just
have
said.
A,
yeah.
I'd have a thousand.
How many personalities can there really be? Or how many?
There's not many.
How many us's? Or how much energy can you recreate? Because energy can't be created or destroyed, so you can't recreate energy. So, like, when something dies, it becomes something else.
Well, actually, there's your answer, Kyle. Actually, you just that.
Here we go.
So
if you don't show up on time, you're not technically the energy. Is that what it is?
Something like that. You're not the energy for my team. No.
I would never play for St. John's, Doug.
All right, but go with me here. If the energy is never if the energy is originally unique or some way, and then it never really dies,
it's
then
it unique. It's not destroyed or created.
It's not destroyed or created, whatever. That means it's going through cycles. So you're going through cycles between different things for we're talking billions and trillions of years kind of thing.
Who is? Because if you believe in evolution, if you believe in certain things, you're not talking that long.
All I'm saying is look at it like almost like a infinity symbol, in that maybe you do become yourself again, but it just takes so many times to become yourself again. I don't know.
Possibly, yeah. There's an answer no one has, and it's an answer no one will have.
I don't think anyone will have it. You're right.
I've tried enough to figure out these answers, and like you're
getting
no
answer. Discussion, man.
It's the age old. Yeah, dude.
How's the wheel spin? How's this work?
But you're right, Kyle. Like, so you're telling me that this little kid's gonna point to the red dot, and that's the thing. You're right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, he points to like his old like choo choo train, and like, knew him, so like you're the fucking Dalai Lama now.
But
a lot of tradition is bad tradition. Like,
I
not all
agree.
Of it's good, you know? And it's just some things just tend to stick, and it's not for any reason that everyone has to believe in or agree with. It just happens to stick, you know?
And you kind of see it now. You kind of see it now with mob mentality, with, like, anything on social media. If someone backs something, whether it's right or wrong, it's as soon as it takes fucking wave, people follow it, it's going to, you know, it's going to be right in the sense of everyone looking at or viewing it, whether it's right or wrong. And it's crazy. It's just a wild time to be alive. Because we're getting fucked.
Sure is. You want to take a five up with that?
Sure.
Brian, where are you at with this? Are you ready to take a five or what?
Like staring at Kyle while he talks.
He's got the other AirPod in so he can hear all this. But he was pretty much staring at me. Yeah.
That's so awkward. Kyle's trying to have a conversation and you're just standing looking at him. He's like, what the
no,
fuck?
He's sitting. Doing? He's sitting. I got a chair for him, dude. I'm not going to stand when you're psycho.
I'm not able to comment on your comments right now.
Chime in by all means. Just whatever.
I have to give him another fucking set of headphones. I can afford these things, dude.
Well, that's right. You're wearing the right one, so that's the one with the mic.
I got the mic. Yeah. I'll give it to Bri.
Bri doesn't have a mic.
I'll give it to Bri for the next.
All right, we'll see you guys in like 5 minutes.
Sounds good, boys. All right.
In a world below these clouds here, two worlds collide. From Atlantic Cinematics comes the story of an airplane, I guess, and an anthem for the anxious who refuse to fly without fear.
There are trials and tribulations.
With Academy Award winner Terry Novak.
No, man, it's a fucking
Introducing Kevin McMaxford.
You want to bring a boy's life? Isn't this?
The Nervous Flyer. Coming this Christmas or next.
Directed by F. Gary Gray.
Let's clear the air for a second. How's married life, Kyle? What's going on? How's the wife?
Where are you guys? Great, been? Man. We're in Worcester. My wife and I are in Worcester, and she's adorable. She's the best thing that's ever happened to me. And Bonner and I, significant others, have the same name, so it could get confusing. But Merce and I have a great life. Like
she works over at that
that what?
Well, my mom, I don't know what you call it. What do you call it?
Garden center.
Yeah.
I'd call it the New England Botanical Garden at Tower Hill, but I don't know what you'd call it. So it's different. Like
up here in Massachusetts.
She's a youth education manager there. And,
I would call it the same thing, Kyle. And she, yeah, my mom says she goes there and she sees her and she's a sweetheart. So
yeah, she is. She's the best. She's my favorite person in the world. Al's mom, Jules, works with her.
Oh, nice.
Jules is looking for something to do. So I call Rainbow, which is, I'll explain that, which as Marissa started in this early education stuff, one day she came back to the house and we were chilling. There was a couple of us. And she came home and said she had to make nature names for all the kids. And they're like, what's your nature name? And hers was Rainbow.
Okay.
We thought it was a joke. I called it Rainbow for a couple of days. And
it stuck.
Six years later, here I am. And I don't know if you've been in a public setting calling someone Rainbow, but you never get good looks from it. Like, especially where, like, we've traveled a lot of this country, which is something I wanted to ask John about, what he thought, because I think you went to the Southwest recently, right? Was it Arizona?
Yeah, we stayed mostly in Phoenix, but did a couple days up in Sedona. And
how beautiful is it out there, man?
Oh, it's amazing. Yeah,
it's fucking unreal. And
we had just done Utah the year before, so it's
What did you do in Utah?
We did Zion National Park. Repping the shirt right now.
Oh, dude, I see that, dude.
And we did a little Salt Lake City. We flew into Vegas for all that, by the way. So we got one night in Vegas. We stayed at Caesar's Palace and did just experience for the night.
I just went to Vegas for work. And I was there by myself for like 3 days.
Oh, my God.
I went to like a Vegas Knights game by myself. It was
awesome.
How many
times you get hit on by fucking hookers?
Dudes? So many dudes. So many dudes.
Kyle gets them from all angles.
Yeah. Yeah, I was like, yeah, they knew I was married because I wear the ring. So like, they were like, how much did like drive you to the strip club? I was like, more than you know, brother. Like, you don't even know. But wow.
Is that a convention out there?
Yeah, we did. It was it's Con Expo or ConEgg. It's a trade show for the construction industry that happens every 3 years, and it's always in Vegas.
And what are you doing now? What do you do with that?
So I work for a company that does material processing solutions. So most of the shit we do is we deal with people in the trash and recycling industry. Mm-hmm. And recycling meaning like food waste, like wood waste.
Not energy and souls.
I'll save those too. I'll save a couple of souls on the way. But it's crazy to see like, I've been doing it for 6 years now, but it's pretty amazing to see, like, on the flip side, like when you're putting out your trash bin, your recycling bin, and where you think this goes, and like what a different world it is. Like,
I heard it's not very good.
Oh, it's not good, dude. Our trash in Massachusetts, it gets put on a train car and it gets brought to a landfill in Ohio. That's where our trash in Massachusetts goes. And so, like,
the new reports about recycling and how much of it's recycled is pretty depressing.
Yeah, well, that goes, like, a lot of people want to, you know, everyone feels like they're recycling, but no one's doing their part. And it's kind of crazy to see.
Well, no, that's what like the recent report was saying. It's like, cause I do that. I divide all plastics, glass, paper, cardboard, like every weekend. And then you hear this report that's like, yeah, we still don't know shit about that. We just throw it all in one container. Yeah,
I mean, down there, they don't.
Well, no, I'm talking internationally. I'm talking globally. Like it's
we're not talking globally because we can't send our trash to China anymore. We've tried that. It's too expensive to send it over the fucking water. So most of our shit goes to rail car. We either send it to West Virginia or we send it to Ohio on rail car. And the problem with that is if you don't shred it and if it's just big bulky waste that you could run through a shredder, I think about how much space you take up, one in a rail car or two in a landfill. And how much space you could create by just shredding that, say that couch.
So is that what you offer?
We sell the machines and solutions to like mm-hmm. figure out whether it's green waste, whether it's wood waste, whether it's recycling. It's like you look at a house that's turned down. We sell the machines that are going to turn that into your mulch that you buy the next year, your bark mulch. That's just pallets that have been grinded. That's a house that was ripped down.
That's a good thing, though, right? That's a good thing, though.
Great thing. It's all stuff that's removed from a landfill. And, you know, all you're doing in a landfill is taking up space. So if you can remove food waste, green waste, metal, wood, like clean wood waste, you're doing everyone a favor. Mm. Especially with food waste. Food waste is so easy to compost.
Yeah, every day, all day, dude. And it goes right into the garden.
It's huge. It's like it's a big thing to do. And like you think if John doing it, if you think of that on like a bigger scale, if everyone's doing that, think of how much trash is just diverted from the landfill or how much trash is put into turning into compost. So that shit you plant your new lawn with, your new garden with, that's just food waste that you've recycled. It's a no-brainer.
Or even,
but you know, when there hasn't been enough education about it. It's crazy.
When you're shopping, like grocery store or whatever, like just not getting bags.
Yeah.
Like, yeah.
Or bring your own bags. Bring your own
simple stuff
bags.
Like that. Or like you look at a lot of the people that do, a lot of people I deal with that do compost food waste, their biggest problem is the stickers. The little stickers that are on your apple.
Yeah. Right, right.
That's the fucking biggest problem. Because when you put those through a screener or you put those through something, guess what? They're small enough where they go through it.
Or like the tea bags. Wait.
Back it up. So so when they go through your systems, the system will pick up the sticker and then divert it to the wrong channel.
Well, if you got the right, so
stickers aren't organic matter.
I understand
that's the issue. Like, so if you're composting food waste,
right?
The only thing you want going through that is compost.
Correct.
And the problem is, if once you process this compost a couple times, you'll take that little sticker on that apple and you'll fucking cut it down to 6-8 times, and then it's too small to get it out of there. And so a lot of times, we have machines that can get out of it. But a lot of times it's the municipalities, it's small fucking freehand companies that are trying to do this and start doing this that they can't spend $500,000 on a company that's going to take.
So that's stickers. That's the fucking food industry's job to change.
It's not.
What do you mean? Like freaking Dole.
What do you mean? What do you mean? Like,
yeah, why can't they just take the Chiquita
bananas?
Yeah.
Like stop putting stickers on your freaking banana peels.
Well, they need to for people like you, Pistol. Those glasses, you couldn't understand what the fucking vegetable was.
Well, it's scanning.
Pull the banana. He's like, this is an apple, dog. Like,
it's more so like easy. A retail. Yeah, it's like
What's the number?
He's like, it's right here, dog.
I did see something cool. That was
kind of a crazy thing that, like, I learned in like all your bark mulch is old pallets, old houses that are turned down. It's just so like, that's all it is.
That's okay by me. I think that's a good thing.
Recycling. It's a big thing, but seeing where your trash goes and knowing where your trash goes. Like I said, like there's no landfills in Massachusetts that are open. Like all our trash.
What about the one in Shrewsbury?
What about
the one in Shrewsbury? Isn't there one in Shrewsbury?
There is.
Yeah,
They don't take trash anymore.
Shrewsbury or Westboro or right on the
Shrewsbury
line.
Shrewsbury had a fucking landfill.
Yeah, they had right a landfill. Route 20. They did. Yes, Route they 20, did. Yeah.
Is it still in business or it's full?
No. It's full. Everything in Massachusetts is full.
Oh, wow.
That's the other problem. Is our shit goes to Ohio. There's a big landfill in Ohio. We could go a decade plus before we ever hit the max there. But it also goes down to West Virginia. But now your trash that's getting picked up, these companies factor those things in. So they have to take that trash, they have to bring it to the transfer station, they have to put it on the train, take that train, they have to bring it to Ohio, they have to unload it. So now
that's a lot of energy right there.
It's a lot of money, is what it is. It's a lot of fucking money. And no one wants to pay that. They put it on that curb and they say, hey, the trash is out of sight, out of mind.
So what are your solutions? Your solutions are to cut down on that money? Let's get to it.
We shred those. So when you're filling that, train car, we'll shred that. So if you have a 100-ton train car, and if you put bulky waste into it, you could probably fit 20 tons into it.
So you would say some of the cause or the wholesome reason.
I would shred that material because naturally,
we can cut it down more and help with less transportation costs. We can help with less.
Well, no, you're already paying the transportation costs. We can put more.
Yeah, I know.
But
you're filling more on the crate. You're filling more in the thing.
So a lot of times these are fixed costs. If you're buying a 100-ton train car and you're only putting 60 tons into it, what are you doing? You're wasting 40 tons. But if I can recoup 20
tons off
that's
my point. Yeah. So you can save them there, and there you go.
Yeah, and that's just trash. That's not dealing with mulch or compost, food waste, wood waste. It's a lot of different things. So
Is this the carting business?
No, I deal with a lot of carting people though.
Yeah.
And like carting is just dumpsters, come to find out.
Yeah.
That's all it is.
Fill and remove. Yeah.
Yeah, that's literally what they do. And then they'll bring it to a transfer station. The transportation will then take it, put in a train car, and then send it to a landfill.
Mm-hmm. So, Kyle, you think the Celts got what it takes?
Ooh.
I don't know, man. Sometimes I do.
I'm coming off a Bruins loss that really fucked me up.
That's depressing.
My betting says the Celts have what it takes to win this series, but I don't.
That's quasi game theory kind of thing too. It's like, if you think it's going to happen, not, I don't know. I disagree.
Cause I talked to Shane. Y'all know Shane, right?
Shane, of course. Dutch master.
Yeah. Shane was here and he was like, yeah, I can't go on that. I have a top secret job. So I was like, all right, I'll do it. But they
whooped ass last night. I get it, but still.
I know. But like, I went in the same, like the first game, I was like, I don't know, this feels like a Sixers win. Didn't bet it. Mm-hmm. They fucking rolled. They were like +340.
Well, what's Harden then, just shot like lights out?
Yeah, but then like Harden's gonna come back down to earth. Then you're thinking Embiid's gonna put fucking 30, 40, and then they rolled him by 35. So it's like, I don't know.
I don't know either.
I don't know.
Do you have faith in Tatum? See, that's the answer. Not
personally.
Really.
Personally, no.
He doesn't have enough fire.
He's the best on the team.
He's considered the best on our team, and I don't want to be that guy, but I think the best on our team. It's Grant Williams.
It's white. Williams.
It's Brown. It's Brown. The best guy on the team is Brown.
And isn't Horford one of the oldest players in the league right now?
He's got to be next to PJ Tucker. Or he's the oldest person that scores points in a game.
Yeah, he's still clutch often.
Well, and he hits threes. What was it? Fucking PJ Tucker. His point spread was when he played 38 minutes in that first game, had 0 points, 0 rebounds, which is fucking insane. Mm-hmm. And they still won. But I think if you take it over a 7-game series, I'd like to think the Celtics have it. But
well, who's the main blockade, you think, for that? I mean,
Jimmy ball game. Jimmy Butler.
I don't know. I think they make it through the Sixers. They roll the Heat, and then I think whoever wins.
Jimmy buckets, man.
Dude, just because you live between the South and here doesn't make you like fucking the South and here, dude.
I don't know.
Get the fuck out of here, dude.
I don't know.
Who are you rooting for? What are you, a Nashville's team? Who do they got?
Memphis Grizzlies, man.
Yeah, how'd they do?
Yep.
I'm not a Grizz. I'm a
How'd they do?
Well, didn't they fire that guy?
They let him go.
Why did they cut him? So what was he doing? He was just talking shit, and they were
what
like,
"What was he doing, Dylan Brooks? What was he?"
I wasn't
doing?
Watching the game, man. I'm a Celts fan.
Oh my god, dude!
I'm not a Memphis Grizzlies fan.
Oh. Wow, dude!
So what? Do you, what
it's all about the Preds in Nashville, right, Pete? It's all about the Preds.
Well, Titans got a good stadium coming. There you go. No, Kyle, what happened? What happened?
I was gonna give Brad the comment, but he didn't want it.
What happened though, Kyle? What happened with the guy? They just cut him because he was talking shit?
With the Grizzlies? No. Yeah. Bro, he talked a bunch of shit about Tory Brown, and then after that they got smoked out. He didn't score a goddamn point after that, dude. He went like 2 for 23 after that, dude.
Brutal.
And they came out and said we are letting him go. Not indefinitely, but they said without, like, there's no chance he comes back. And there's no other team that's ever said this about a player before. They were like, we're cutting him, and there's no chance he comes ever back. Like, this boy talked to himself so far out of the league. Like,
jeez.
I love that shit, man.
But you kind of got to like respect it at the same time. Yeah. Like the man was, you know, Memphis was ahead. He talked shit to LeBron and he stood by it. And, you know, maybe he ends up in China and makes, you know, a few million less than he's been on. I don't fucking know.
Whatever.
That's what I'm saying. Whatever, dude. Who gives a shit?
All right, let's get to the arrests. Shrewsbury arrests. Kyle Howe.
Were you at CFITS?
Nope.
No,
not at CFITS.
I'll be there.
Nope. Was going to pick someone up at CFITS, drove away. As they called them and said, hey, there's a bunch of cops around in this place. You should get the fuck out.
Yeah, not necessarily arrests, but like interesting brush-ins with the law. Maybe you got out of something, you know?
Yeah, you got a lot of shit.
Maybe you got a Bosch story for us.
Oh, no boss stories. Are we okay? No boss stories. Cool. Nah. Last stories are Davey was some of the funnest shit like back in the day. It was just kind of redundant. Like everyone's talked about Davey on this. So
Not really.
Not really. No. What did you do with Davey?
So I'll give you a story. When David lived up at UMass, he didn't actually go there, which I think has been said here. He had a girl.
That's so awesome.
There's Abby. Abby lived up there, so he lived up there for a while. So I didn't go to college because I was like, that's a waste of time. I'm not going to spend my money on college, but I'm going to make money. I'm not going to be pistol with these glasses and shit. But no.
I'm with you, Kyle.
I can only say that because Bob is with me.
Oh, because my college experience was so much about academic stuff. Did you come to my house?
I'm talking about the governmental debt that you are in. And most
I paid that off, brother.
Okay. You should have waited by now.
All right, back to the story. What were you and Davey doing? Stealing signs?
What? No.
So one time, steal signs on it?
There's one time we came back and Davey's girl, so when he lived out there, he lived with his girlfriend, Abby. And I don't know if I'm tripping on
it. Yeah, I vaguely remember her.
Yeah, when he lived at it was before townhouse. He lived at Brandywine on the because you used to go up there.
Oh yeah,
I'm sure you came up and like me and Jay Vig used to leave on like a Friday from Worcester, and we used to go to Great Big Valley liquor store. Jay would use his Mexican fake ID, get a bottle of fucking we get a bottle of Evan Williams a handle and just head up there on a Friday. I said, Ma, I'll see you like Sunday. See you, bye.
Yep. And so we go up there and we just hang out. We just drink a bunch. Abby would go nuts. Fucking hated it. There's one time we leave and we're all at a party one time. It's just like time to go. And like, I don't know if you remember this part, but they had like a frozen pond in the middle. And like, there's like a night we're walking back.
There's like a courtyard area in the back.
Yeah. But they had like a frozen pond. Yeah. And it's like 3 a.m. in like January. And there's like, ice skate. And I was like, dude, no ice skate, dude. I can't fucking. I haven't put a fucking skate on. Since I started skiing, I haven't put a skate on my feet. And it's like, it's me, Davey, and Jay, who all have like 13 size feet. And so Davey's like, dude, if you guys, I have 3 pairs of size 12. And I was like, fuck out of here, dude. Like,
yes, yeah.
So we go out there, and we're just fucking skating around 3 a.m. I haven't skated since I started skiing. So, like, half the time, I was just like, call the ambulance, dude, call the ambulance. My fuck, I'm, like, on my back, just, like, like fuck. I was like,
why am I here?
I came out confident.
Why am I doing this?
Like, I hit this shit, like, and I was just like, don't. it was bad. But there was another time when she worked for the Worcester, I want to say it was the Worcester Sharks at that time. And so it was the minor team that was at the Centrum. It was the Whalers. It was the Sharks at the time. But I could be wrong here, but so she worked for this team because she went into like managing, like sports management. And so she managed that team. And with Davey living at home with Deb and Shrewsbury, she lived there too. And so there's one day where she worked for the team, and so she would get Davey tickets. And we went there, I think it was me, Davey, Al, and I want to say Foley was with us. But we went and got like a little drunk before and like went in, and Abby was like, hey, my family's coming, like they're out of town, like whatever you do, don't let Davey get drunk. And I was like, I got you. I have any control over this fucking kid. I'm telling him not to get drunk, but I'm sitting there next to him, like, nah, like who the fuck am I? And so we fucking, she just goes, she's working, so she's like, she's fucking floating around in her like suit, and she's doing her thing. And we just come down like the concourse, and it's just Abby sees, like, oh my god, and Davey's just fucking stumbling hard. And I'm like, dude, pick your shit up, man. I'm just trying to like pick them up. Like, I'm just like, dude, get shit together. Like, it's her like family and family friends, and hang with fucking Davey's like, die, 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 die. I'm just like, dude, you gotta get shit together. Because she's already asked me to like make sure he's sober. And I'm like, well, this is such an irrational thing to ask me. And I'm like, I'm not gonna be able to do this. Like, and so here we go. And then, like, before we get to them, like, security guards stop us. And they're like, what's wrong with you? And he's like, nothing. And I was like, fuck, here we go. Like, and so they asked him like 12 times. And I'm like, all right, dude, you gotta go. I said, dude, they throw him out. And they throw him out. I'm like, I don't know if you've been to the Centrum, but there's like a section. It's also like this smoking section, but it's this big set of stairs. So I kind of throw them out there, and we're already out there like smoking butts. We're like, oh, you got fucking tossed, dude. And we're like, we're going to go back in. And he's like, ooh. And he just shows he has another ticket. So there's another ticket because he got it for free. And so we're like, fuck, whatever. So we go back inside. And next thing you see is Davey coming in from the other entrance of his ticket. Nice. Nice. He's coming down the hallway this, like he's walking and the fucking security guy's turning around going, not you, and they just grab him and throw his ass on him.
Love the effort.
No, I tell you, the kid at least is an effort. We left one time and we went to Clark, Clark, and it was just fucking
Clark.
Yeah,
oh, yeah, I remember. When was he at Clark? Was he playing basketball?
It was like a freshman. I don't think he was doing anything. His roommate was doing a bunch of coke, but I don't think he was doing anything.
Came back comes up on every podcast, so as long as it came up here, good. So there you go. I got some text messages coming in from your boy, the Mr. Producer over there, Brian Terrell.
Oh, What are you saying?
He's saying to bring up what Cheers means to you, the show, because I freaking love Cheers. Means to me? I fucking love that show.
Cheers means what the song means, dude.
Where everybody knows your name. Yeah,
there's the microphone. That's why Kyle doesn't sound good.
Oh, that's right. Kyle's all fuzzy because he's got the mic.
Oh, it's switched.
Switched.
Did it come to your boy?
What is he? You got the headset?
BT's coming in clear as day, and we couldn't hear Kyle very well. Yo?
Yo.
Oh, dude.
Yeah, Brian. Much better.
Much better.
You fucked us up, dude.
Infiltration. Total infiltration.
Have you ever heard the full set of that song, though? It gets kind of weird.
What do you mean?
The intro song to When Everybody Knows Your Name.
Oh, yeah.
And they're always glad you came.
You want to know where people go. Where everybody knows your name.
I did that song. But as the song continues, it gets kind of interesting.
Okay. What do you mean?
I mean, I actually don't really remember, but I just remember someone telling me that. So that's all I got.
No, I know. I think it's pretty standard, dude. It's a feel good.
It's a great song. It's a fantastic
song.
Gary Portnoy and Judy Hart Angelo.
Yeah.
No names.
Can you play this live, dude?
Portnoy.
No names, dude.
Dave's taking it hot right now for the Mincy,
millions
dude.
Of dollars off see that? One song.
No,
one
what did song. Dave? What did he do? What did Dave? What did I do?
No, it was just that the dude Mincy on Barstools. He's doing live shit and he said the N word.
Oh no!
But he was just like literally like reading like a Bone Thugs and Harmony lyrics and like read it.
Yeah,
and then like everyone was like, "You have to cancel him," and Dave was like, "I wouldn't cancel him," and it's like, yeah. Well. That's what's happened when you sell out to Penn, because Penn was like, "You got to get rid of him because they'll fucking take our gaming license." So just like, he's gonna get turned out as like a bitch right now.
Wow.
Wait a minute. I don't know this stuff. I'm not that in tune with the gambling scene. Barstool gambling is owned by who?
Penn. Penn Gaming.
And Penn
gaming. Entertainment. Penn Entertainment.
And they're a bigwig.
Huge.
I don't gamble much. Yeah, go ahead. So wait.
Tell.
So yeah. So Penn is owned by. I still won our fantasy football league. So whatever. Anyway, and
no, you didn't.
I won this year.
Oh, Shane won this year.
I won this year.
Shane, you won last year. Shane won this year.
I won this year.
Shane won this year.
You and I won last year.
I don't pay any of you fuckers, so I don't give a
I don't
shit.
Pay, I think you paid. Maybe you didn't pay me.
Penn,
You paid me. Penn.
You just lucky. You just checked. Bri didn't. Oh, Bri's fucked up right now.
No, Bri paid me. Bri paid. You all paid me. Someone didn't.
No. Penn Gaming owns Barstool now.
Okay. And they're big, and now they're corporate owned.
They're corporate owned. That was the issue. Is that they hired a kid and he did. He was doing a wake up show and they convinced him to do a live wake up show and he did a live show, and he was just reading Bone Thugs and he just said,
"Yeah."
You know,
well, he's reading.
What I'm not going to say.
I don't think that's cancel.
Literally
that's not
reading.
Cancelable.
Yeah.
Canceler.
But that's that. That was like the thing that like Dave came out and said. He was like, I wouldn't, and it's like, that's what a sellout is. This is the definition of a sellout. It's like, you sold out to Penn. Penn makes these decisions now. Like, you don't make these decisions anymore.
Mm-hmm.
Because, like, his decision could fucking inflect, like, on gaming licenses in different states.
It's a lot of work.
Yeah, very
expensive,
too.
It's a lot of money.
Too.
Fuck work. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Fuck work. It's money.
So, but do you like the show? Cheers.
The show?
No, Cheers. The show, Cheers. You freaking watcher?
Dude, I love Cheers, dude. I'm a big Cheers guy. Who's your favorite character on Cheers? Name him first. Go ahead.
Woody.
Coach. Reggie.
So are those, Woody and Coach, are those the same answer?
No, they're not. They're two different people.
No, two different
they
people.
Be the same answer.
Played
they
the same role,
the same.
Though, right? Kind of.
I mean.
No, good to know because that's always the... question.
My answer would be
Ted.
Who?
Well, I mean, I was going to say Ted Danson, but
Danson, that's not his name.
Sam Malone. I have an idea of opening up a bar somewhere that's called Sam Malone's. It's called Sam Malone's.
You don't even know what his name is, though.
There's definitely a Nashville bar called Sam Malone's, dude.
No, there isn't. They don't.
There definitely is.
No.
There will
why?
Be
who's your, who's your favorite? You like, I don't know.
I'm a Norm guy. I will say I'm a Norm guy. Norm.
I named my dog.
That's who you named it. You've never seen an episode of the show. You named your dog after.
Dude, don't BT me right now. Don't fucking BT me right now.
How about.
Dude, I'll let BT you.
You've been hanging around with BT too much, man. Don't tell me Don't tell me I haven't seen an episode of Cheers. And don't
you
tell
just
me that
said
I didn't.
That.
Don't tell me that.
Who just said that, dude?
What?
You just said you'd never seen Cheers.
No, I didn't.
Am I wrong about it?
No, I said I never heard the introduction song. Yeah. I've seen seasons and seasons.
This is where your production comes in. You just play the Cheers intro song.
Yeah. Someday. I liked Frasier. I thought Frasier was a cool character too because it spawned a whole new television show that was also sick.
The shows were so basic. They were so good for them.
Oh my god!
They were just so basic. They were like in this episode.
I agree with John here. I agree with John that like Frasier is a crazy character because he literally spawned a whole like fucking like show. Like,
I think they have a new one coming out. No, did you hear that?
No,
it's called Queers.
No, I heard.
It's called Queers.
2022, everyone gets canceled.
Yeah. No, but I think that I heard a rumor that Frasier's coming out again. Not
with
of the
his
closet.
Dad who died. Yeah.
Not of the so closet, sick. But of an episode.
His little brother.
I'm looking it up right now. Frasier reboot.
You should put a computer behind your camera so you don't have to look down at your phone.
I know. We're trying to work that out. It's baby steps, Kyle. Frasier reboot, returning cast, story, and everything we know. The Frasier reboot is arriving on Paramount Plus, and production is underway.
Yeah, Paramount Plus is trying to do some big things.
I like Paramount Plus. I don't watch Monk.
I heard all the fucking throwback Nickelodeon shows are on Paramount.
Are they? Is that where they're at?
Yeah, Pete and Pete.
Yeah, I think so.
Fucking
yeah.
All
yeah.
That shit is on
Fox.
There.
Fox owns Paramount.
And if Fox owns,
oh, that's the one. You guys, or what shows you guys? What shows you guys watching these days?
I need a new one. I don't know.
We just finished Better Call Saul.
Nice. That's a show I gotta really like dive into because
it's heavy, it's deep.
I was just like a fuck Jesse guy. I hated Jesse so much. So when like El Camino came out, I was just
I love
like
Jesse.
Oh, that makes so much sense. Yeah, we were just so
yo bitch.
I couldn't stand that kid.
The only reason he's alive is because of Walter.
Jesse. And like I can't fucking stand Jesse.
Did you watch the movie?
I watched it. I watched it with so much spite. I wanted to fucking kill myself, dude. It was so fucked up. It was so fucked.
You watched it with spite. He still watched
it. Shane was next to me just like, I love Jesse. I was like, dude, you're a piece of shit too, dude. Like, for no reason. Like, I was just so fucking, like...
Dude,
like the only reason that dude has success or is still alive is because Walter let him be. Like, you know,
I mean,
Walter,
he's not
like,
a guy that I would want to like grab a beer with, dude. I just thought he was good for the plot.
I agree, but like when they made that movie, I was like, this piece of shit, he don't deserve this. Like, I don't know, man. I don't know.
Yeah, what a universe, man. The Breaking Bad universe.
Cool, like, I was like, that was like, that's.
I got
show,
nothing.
Like,
I got no shows right now. I got nothing. I watched.
You guys watched Yellow Jackets at all?
No. Is that supposed to be good? What's the premise?
I don't know if it's supposed to be good, but like, it's.
Well, Is it, what's the premise? What's the, I mean?
Well, I'll give you a Showtime fucking intro to show you. I don't know. It's little girls like.
That's an interesting premise.
It's a high school soccer team that they take a flight to go to nationals, and on that flight they crash, and then they have to fucking survive from there. It's a really good fucking spin on it, and like Christina Ricci is one of the like characters, and like I thought it was gonna be really bad, and it's like really good show. Like it's
is like, it, once I see, is it like a horror thriller?
Both. It's like Lord of the Flies mixed with like a Dexter vibe, if that like yeah, helps you, I guess.
Yeah, no, that's good. Yeah.
And I don't wanna like spoil anything, but it's worth watching. Because I went into it like this shit's gonna be dumb as fuck, but like it's
what'd you think of The Last of Us?
As I played the video game, so I liked it a lot.
Okay.
I don't know if you can see behind me, but I like to play video games.
Really?
I know.
I like to play video games. I try to do Anxiety Guy upstairs, but that just says this is a PlayStation logo. And so that's all I got.
Anxiety relief guy.
I'm looking.
Yeah.
I'm looking at the image or poster you have on your wall with my glasses as if it's like an eye test, because I don't know what I'm looking at. Is that like different letters? Is this an eye exam?
No, that is it's actually a you ever played like SpaceX where they drop down? That's what it is. It just says game on.
No, don't know anything about game on.
I know you
don't.
Okay. That's Biggie below it. That's a big Biggie. Yeah, so you want to know that? Yeah. Like, Pistol, you wouldn't know because you went to a different high school, but Bado would know Pinch. You remember Pinch, right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, Pinch.
Well,
yeah.
Pinch lived right on Irita.
Yeah, he lived on Irita.
Yeah. But he also became good friends with, like, Cap. And there was one time, like, he hung out with him, and, like, he brought down to, like, the reservoir by Cap's house. And, like,
oh, yeah, dude. After that, Lappy at Cappy's.
Yeah, it was like a whole different world down there, man. Like, there's one time he was like, you know, he said this to me. He was like, you know how I knew you were hard? He was like, Al one time like tried to sack tap you and then ran away, and you just took a full beer and just chucked it at his head and knocked it off his dome. And I was like, there's no way I did that, dude. Like, I love Al. But I was like, yeah, it might have happened. Though.
You blocked it out.
Oh, yeah, he blocked it in, dude. It was so weird. Dude, that night, even fucking, we left, it was a senior appreciation dinner, and they were like, dance or some shit, and they were like, as long as you show up tomorrow, we don't give a fuck. And we just went and got, like, blacked out.
Nice.
And just had a night at the reservoir by Cabs. And just
that was that, yeah. You know who lived over there was Travis Creed. You remember that, Monter? Way back when?
I knew he lived there.
Way. He wasn't there at that time.
No, he moved to Reno. Yeah.
Danny Galata lived over there too.
Yeah.
Pete, do you know about Lappy at Cappy's? Do you know what that is?
Are you talking about Ron Capuano?
Yeah, a Lappy at Cappy's.
Whoa. No, what is that?
So Capuano's house was situated like right in the middle of a yard, pretty much, like all surrounding.
He's on 122 Reservoir Street. Yeah,
and it was the perfect. You could drive right onto the lawn and take a lap around his fucking yard and come right back out and just like. So many people did it. He like condoned it for like a long time until he got in trouble for doing it.
Yeah, because you're fucking up the yard. That's
it's funny is how we started it. We started it because his dad had a Jeep Grand Cherokee, and he got a new one. And so he had one that was just sitting in the driveway with no plates, no registration sticker, and he would go to sleep. And so we would just take this thing, and we'd fucking drive it up and down the road. And we hit this dirt road. And we're going down it, boom, 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 boom. And fucking Al's giggling, hilarious. And this dude just comes out, right? fucking pump shotgun pointed at us. And no way. Like, I'm driving this Jeep with no plates, no shit. It's like 5 a.m. because this is when we took the shit. And so I turn around and I go back. I go back all the way to Caps. And this is like a night where, like, Al's mom, Jules, wouldn't let him stay anywhere. So we had the lady next door come over and handle the phone call. And she's like, I'm Kathy's mom. Like, they're great to stay here. That wasn't so, like, they stayed here. Everyone's here.
Who was that lady?
It was just it was just Cap's neighbor. Literally,
that was just neighbor. Willing to just do that.
Literally, just willing to do that. It was insane, dude.
That's interesting.
And I was like, she calls my mom. I'm fucking done. I'm fucking cooked, dude. So we do this, and I remember because it was like, it was the first time I ever like drove high. And like we took this Jeep to like White City to McDonald's Drive, and I was just like high, and I was just like, they're like, "What do you want?" And I was just like,
There was one time where Mrs. Pignataro, Trish Pignataro, took me, Jimmy, and remember Corey and Casey, John.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
I remember.
You remember those two? And we were, yeah, conservice. We were, we got too stoned, off bongs, right? We used to rip bongs. I'd die if I did that.
So sick, dude.
But anyway,
great, yeah, in
person.
But that time we went for the award training and we went to fucking, this isn't live, you can end this shit, but we left Ward Hill, right? We took that megaphone and we went to Spags. And I remember Alan, Mitch, Mike just being like, "Oh, we gotta steal all this shit, dude." And I'm like, "You know those cameras are very real, those bubble cams." And they were like, "Nah, those aren't real." And I was like, "Those are so real, dude." And so they like just like took CD players and shoved them down their pants and walked out.
What are you gonna do with a CD player?
Dude, Spags was really easy to steal from. I used to work there. That was my first like job as a teenager.
You worked at Spags?
I worked at Spags, yeah.
No way. I didn't know that.
My aunt Diane worked in the paint department and I worked in the electronics department.
Selling like amps and stuff?
No, just you remember the electronics section. It was a bunch of bullshit. Batteries. Like, yeah, batteries and fucking like shitty
Duracell,
shitty dismans and fucking. But
that's what we went into.
I was just telling Marissa this story the other night. Was that so Spags had this like back room warehouse where they stored all their inventory.
Yeah.
And if you remember, they had a luggage section as well with like pretty decent luggage.
Sense, dude.
So there's all the luggage is like packed away in this warehouse. And I used to go up to the warehouse and fucking throw a couple down on the ground and just fucking pass out for like 45 minutes.
Remember
then come back
Spags
on the floor.
Great. That's great.
Spags, yeah, Spags had the McDonald's like fucking like train car where they were like, "We just sell hot dogs and french fries."
Yes, I do remember that. That,
dude,
was,
that cool. Was insane.
Oh, yeah. That's that was awesome. Like, yeah.
That was awesome.
Like, and then they'd have like 25 cent hot dog days where you just had like. No, nickel. No, 25 cents. You get a hot dog, a soda, you get chips. So you go down there with like, it'd be 5 cents. You go down there with a quarter and just like throw it at this man, like I was like
going after Hostess. Like, remember going to Hostess,
like, dude?
Hostess was awesome.
Yeah, Hostess got me too. Fucking Hostess.
I mean, from our neighborhood, he used to have the bike trail on the back end, and we go to Hostess.
Dude, it was just crazy. Like growing up, I don't know.
Hostess was like, they had to be like a nickel. They were so cheap. How are they so cheap?
That was a thing when they had like...
What, the cupcakes?
Yeah, they had a whole freaking retail store. Kyle, what was that angle? Like, Hostess had a retail spot?
It was just, it was Hostess retail, dude. Like, there was no angle. There's no angle we had, dude. It was just like...
It was like, we got bread. We got
cookies. I was like, cookies, dude, I can get a loaf of Wonder right now, dude. But, like, anyone can get it. But we had, like, this, like, back, like trail that would come up the backside, and like we were like thought we were so fucking
Mark Belanger there.
dude.
Yeah, I remember dude. Mark Belanger. Dude. Wow, we got to get him on the queue. In the queue, I'd love to see Mark Belanger on this.
Dude, good luck, dude. You Dixon. Might as well just call this
Bonner. You were close with Mark Belanger, weren't you, Bonner?
Yeah, I'm like first grade, Pete.
No well, way. I mean, he wasn't there in person.
People don't forget.
People don't forget. Yeah. That's another thing, man. Like, who would you like to see on here, Kyle? Give us your top three.
Honestly, I don't know. I don't know. Like, you
it could be have, any like, three people. They could be freaking Keanu Reeves. We don't care. We're gonna go for it.
I mean, don't make all three. Mark Masale.
Okay. Wow. Okay.
I proposed Greg Kasparian actually a couple months ago.
I would take Mark Masale over Greg Kasparian.
Mark's
a better person. So yeah.
Savage.
You heard it here first.
All right, Mark Masale. Two more. We need two more.
Take Pistol's brother-in-law. I think he'd be a good one.
Johnny
Madison.
Oh come on.
Jeremy, the other one. It's Jeremy Meyer that lives in North Carolina.
RJ, your other brother-in-law.
Oh, my other RJ. Yeah. RJ is hilarious.
I think he'd be.
Him on here for sure.
I think he'd be a good one.
Yeah, he would be. I still laugh at his freaking speech at his brother's wedding, dude. It was so funny.
I'm sure I'll see you at his. Are you going to his bachelor?
No, I'm not in that circle.
I'm so in that circle. I have to pay to go.
He's representing Gleason Road, is he not? Come on now.
This is me, dude. What the fuck?
No, I'm talking about Ryan's business that's right on Gleason Road, right?
Yeah.
That's a cool thing. No?
No, dude.
Okay, maybe it's not. All right, moving on.
No, I think anyone that has balls enough to start their own business and fucking really like do that shit, I think that takes a lot, especially these days, you know.
Yeah.
To find something that you're ingrained with, and
yeah,
I don't know what you're about to say, but I'm not gonna agree with it, dude.
No, you're gonna agree with what I'm about to say.
Tell me what I'm gonna do, dude. Fuck you, dude.
Wow.
What are you going to say, bro?
I was going to say, how long had that wedding gown dress place been there prior to him? I mean, that was there forever.
It's still there, dude.
Is that still there?
No, he's there now.
He's there now.
Ike's Den?
Yes. What was that?
Ike's Den, yeah.
I don't know. It was the same thing as it is now. It's just like a sign I saw, and I never knew what it was, dude.
Have you ever been inside?
No.
I've never been inside. Me neither.
I'm terrified of that, dude.
Me too. We never went in.
No, dude.
We lived there.
My parents still live there.
They've never been in. Oh, man.
Like for a while, there's a couple of doors down. I never went.
Did anyone go in there? Did girls get like their prom dresses there?
Yeah, something like that. Well, Trippies. People go to Trippies a lot.
Trippies is sick, dude.
Mike Fox.
Dude.
How about the gun room? Remember the gun room?
I remember the gun room, dude. That's the first place they told me, get the fuck out, dude.
I know. I think me, Steve, and Cody wandered in there one day when we were like 14, like 15. It's kind of like a couple. Can we help you guys? You know,
we're like 11 because that's where they put they plow all the snow to the back, and so we would just climb on this shit.
Yes,
and
then
like
yeah.
If it's so, remember, we just wander in and like be like 9, and just like wander in. Like, well, no, they can't stop us.
We were afraid. I mean, I remember like we were afraid to even go in, or like we were
totally it was terrifying, dude.
Yeah,
that's funny you said Mike Fox, because Mike Fox essentially lived where like Bonner's cousin did in that same building and like
that same house. I told you that, right, Bonner?
Yeah.
I used to play in that house in the basement. We used to have Legos and we used to play and whatever.
it's wild.
I wasn't talking shit to RJ, but RJ is one of them. Okay, so you got RJ, Mark Masale. I don't know a lot about Mark, but I'd be happy to talk to him.
I think he was on our eighth grade team, Pete. I think he was on.
Yeah, silver. No, we're yeah. cool. It's yeah. just I don't.
What was it? Eight what?
Silver,
bro.
No way. Dude.
Yeah, dude.
No, dude. That's
Kate Berry.
We were seven gold. Me and Shane were seven gold.
I think I was on gold too, Kyle.
Yeah, you were with the fucking what's her name?
Where'd he go?
He went.
Where'd you go, Kyle? You pulled a Houdini on us there.
Building
the American yeah. dream. No, I gotta inhale, right?
Building the American dream.
Yes, that's the Reagan. Yes. All right, peace, brother. Kyle, it's good to see you.
All right.
Good to see you. We love you. Hell
Thanks
yeah.
Thanks for coming on, brother.
Thanks for coming on. Come back again. We hope you come back soon.
Thanks for listening, everybody.